We needed to put your hands together to the glory of our King as usual. DG, are you ready for this? Let's go.
My brain is the water, my enemy's drowning.
Shout hallelujah. Thought I couldn't do that, right? Sometimes, you know, when you're in the presence of God, you get lost. You get missing. You get lost in His presence. Let's go around and welcome one another. Say, welcome to church. Welcome to Christ Villa. A place of impact. A place of impact. Welcome to my church. Your church. Christ Villa. I know I only have about 5 more minutes now, so since I've used most of it to sing, I'll still be a good leader by leading by example. Praise the Lord. Let's open our Bible to the book of Judges, chapter 2, verse 10. Judges, chapter 2, verse 10. So last week, I was in a conference of Nigerian therapists, and one of us decided that one of the lectures that he was going to give is going to be on living will. These are the questions that we always ask patients. Do you have a living will? Guess what? I ask them every day, but I don't have one. So the guy said, look, we're all in our 50s going up there. Why don't you create one? Everything that we see in the physical are the things that are copied from the scriptures. From the scriptures. So let's open our Bible. Let's read. Also, all the people of that generation were gathered to their fathers in death, and another generation arose after them who did not know the Lord, nor even the work that He has done for Israel. Praise the Lord. Every responsible man or woman should have a will. If you don't have one, I started 1 month ago, I didn't finish it. We should have one. When you look through the Bible, lots of people have will. Jesus Christ have His will. His will, go into the world, preach the gospel. Joshua had a will. As for me and my house, we'll serve the Lord. The reason why these guys didn't know anything about the fact that there's God in Israel who has done wondrous things among them is because there's no spiritual baton being passed to them. The Bible says in the book of Proverbs, a wise man leaves inheritance for his children's children.
And many of us, when we think about this thing, we think of it in the areas of material wealth. No. A man who cannot write a will to give somebody material wealth would not do anything spiritually. So, what does it mean? What is the meaning of legacy? Legacy is anything that you and I would leave for people that will come after us. So from ancestors to the one living now. The will is not really for somebody who is dying. It's for the people who are living. Otherwise, the state of Maryland would distribute your things the way they want to, the way they fit to them. We have so many definitions of legacy, but the second one is what I want us to focus on. Something handed over, handed down from an ancestor or a predecessor or from the past, especially legacy of religious wisdom, freedom. Many of us are living as if there's no tomorrow. We're in the month of revival. One of the aspects of revival is living legacy. If there's a revival and things are going all around us, then people, when we're long gone, people will say, you know what? In 2023, something happened. That's a legacy that we need to live on. So today, Christ Villa, my charge to you is that how would you like to be remembered? What would you like to be remembered for? Are you leaving a legacy? These guys, even though they were gone, they didn't leave a good legacy for their children because there's no spiritual baton. The funny thing about God is always God of three. When you look at it, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Why would the Bible be so interested in three generations? Leave inheritance for his children's children, which means you, your son, your grandchildren. You, your daughter, your grandchildren. Now, you might be telling me today and say, you know what, it's late. I'm a grandpa. I didn't teach my son. It's not too late. It's not too late. God is a God of second, fourth, fifth chances. It's a reviver. So you can start all over today by teaching your grandchildren. You might have missed it with your sons or with your children. But it's not too late to start with your children, grandchildren. Because you must always, always, always be able to leave something behind. The pictures that you see above on the screen, I think, yeah. Every one of those guys are going to leave legacy behind, whether they like it or not. The question is, what kind of legacy? Do you know who was sitting down with the cap? That's PSK. In his prime. Still in prime anyway. And Pastor B, man, that was me. That's me. But all of us are going to leave something behind, whether we like it or not. Everybody wants to leave something. The question we should ask ourselves, what do I want to leave behind? Let's rise up on our feet. Let's rise up on our feet as we pray. Ask God Almighty to help you to leave a good legacy behind. My pastor says something. Every day is either people are leading you to your destiny or they are leading you away from it. Every single day that we wake up and breathe, we're leaving our footprints in the sand of time. Ask God Almighty to help you to live a good life. To live a life of faith, service, and faith behind for your children. A life that is lived so that my children know that, okay, my dad goes to church. It's baseless. It's nothing unless I leave them with love, service, and faith. I should be able to tell them about my faith so that they can live right. Ask God Almighty to help you and I to live this life, a life of service, a life of love, and a life of faith. Christ Villa has made up his own mind. He has written his will. The will of Christ Villa is to make impact. What is your will? What will be your legacy? Ask God Almighty to help you. Ask the Lord Almighty to help you. In Jesus' wonderful name we pray. Let's have a good service.
Good morning and welcome to Christ Villa. I'm Ebane Takimamana and here are this week's announcements. The month of July here at Christ Villa is our month of supernatural revival. The scripture is taken from Habakkuk 3 verse 2, which reads, O Lord, I have heard your speech and was afraid. O Lord, revive your work in the midst of the years. In the midst of the years, make it known. In wrath, remember mercy. Our prayer is that the Lord will bring alive every dying virtue. He will reignite the fire of revival in our lives, our families, and in our land, in Jesus' name. We are so blessed to have you here worshiping with us on this beautiful Sunday morning here at Christ Villa Church. We pray that you will experience God in a new dimension here today, in Jesus' name. We acknowledge all of our online members and those of you worshiping in person, especially those of you worshiping with us for the very first time. To all of our first-time worshipers, we celebrate you. Our welcome team will be glad to meet with you and tell you more about the church immediately after service. Join us on Monday at 7 p.m. for our hour of prayer and on Wednesdays at 7 p.m. for our Rhema Hour Bible study. Both services will be held via Zoom. Remember that our annual summer dress down is still on. Please be aware, casual but decent dressings only. Are you between the ages of 18 and 24? Get ready to rev up your engines and join LeadX for our adrenaline-pumping go-kart outing on Sunday, June 30th, right after church. Transportation and entry will be provided for free, so don't miss out on this incredible opportunity to connect with a group of Jesus-loving young adults. Register today by scanning the QR code on the screen to secure your spot and ensure a seat. Mark your calendars. Christ Villa's annual picnic is coming up on Saturday, August 5th at 12 p.m. All men are encouraged to make generous donations in support of the picnic. All donations are tax deductible. Please see Brother Peter if you're interested in joining CVFC. Practice will take place today at Randallstown High School at 5 p.m. If you're interested in joining weekly Zumba classes, please reach out to see Sister Josephine. The classes are held every Saturday at 10 a.m. Our monthly Peniel Encounter Night is coming up on Friday, July 28th. The theme for this month is Lift Up Your Heads to Ye Gates. Communion will be served. Hope to see you all there. Wisdom Group meet every first Sunday of the month immediately after church service in the sanctuary and holds a monthly prayer meeting every last Sunday of the month via Zoom at 7 p.m. If you are aged 60 and above and would like to join the Wisdom Group, please reach out to see Pastor Awugbeson at the number displayed. New partner training starts today. If you would like to become a worker, please reach out to see Brother Tosin Kayode for more information. Mark your calendars. Christ Villa's third Health Awareness Week kicks off on Sunday, August 6th. We will be talking about physical and nutritional wellness. If you would like to know more about the right African meals that can still keep your waistline snatched, or how to be more aware of cancer risk and how to avoid them, make sure to be in attendance. This is highly informative and a very interactive session, and this is for you. Tell a friend to tell a friend. Service starts at 9 a.m. with praise leader Femi Owoyemi. We'll be dancing like David danced, so wear loose, breathable, and comfortable clothing. See you there. In the year 2023, let us put aside every weight that easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking onto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Videos of all stream services are available on YouTube. Engage with another member one-on-one so we can partner to create lasting impact in our community. That's it for CVTV this week. We'll see you next week.
Put those hands together for Jesus is what your prayers this morning. Hallelujah. About 2 weeks ago, I gave a charge and the Lord told us to review a song called New Wine. We looked at a few lyrics of that song. We came up with a few understanding as to what we need to do going forward. This morning, the choir has come to sing that song to us, that we may have a better understanding of the message that was passed to us 2 weeks ago. It's my desire that as we trust God in this season of revival, that we have a new wine coming out of our new skin in the name of Jesus. So please open up your hearts and be blessed.
Father, we bless your name. Lord, we are ready. Touch our hearts, oh God.
Make us flow with new wine in the name of Jesus.
Yeah, yeah.
We open our hearts to you, God.
In the crushing, in the pressing, you are making new wine. In the soil I surrender, you are breaking new ground. So I yield to you into your playful hands. When I trust you, I don't need to understand. So make me a vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. Lord, I came here with nothing but all you have given me. Jesus, bring your wine out of me.
Somebody just slip those hands to heaven. I said, Lord, you can use me, God. Use me, Lord. You can make your way me. Yeah. Oh, it's in the crushing, in the pressing. Slip those hands and say, Lord,
make me an offering. Make me whatever
God
you want me to be.
I came here with nothing.
Lord, I came here with nothing.
Everything I have you gave
but
to
me. All that you have given me.
Jesus,
bring your wine out of me.
Jesus, bring new wine out of me.
Jesus,
bring
I want to be just like you. Jesus, renew I.
Yes, God.
Out of this me, I want to be new. New wineskin, I want to be just like you. Jesus, bring your wine out of me. So, make me a vessel.
Yes, God.
Make me an offering. Make me whatever.
I expect yes, you to sing it now.
You want me to be.
Hey,
yeah. Lord, I came here with nothing.
Oh.
But all that you have given me.
You stay right there and say,
I came here with nothing.
Lift your hands and say, Lord, I came here with
all that you have given me.
Lord, I came,
Lord,
here.
I came here with nothing. Yeah, yeah, yeah. But all that you have given me.
Stay right there, stay right there.
Lord, I came here with nothing. But all that you have given me, Lord, I came here with nothing.
Oh,
but all that you have given me, Jesus, bring me wine out of.
And you sing that song right where you are. Say, Jesus,
Jesus, bring me wine out of.
Right where you sit and sing it to the Father. Say, Jesus,
Jesus, bring me wine.
Your hands to your Father, say, Jesus,
Jesus, bring new wine.
Two more times, everybody, where you are, say, Jesus,
Jesus, bring new wine.
For the last time, everybody, lift your voice and say, Jesus.
That song says, Jesus, bring out a new wine out of me. But that comes with a cost. To get a new wine, it has to be pressed. It has to be crushed for the new wine to come out. My prayer is that out of you, the Lord will bring a new wine in the name of Jesus Christ. Let's give our hands to Jesus. Hallelujah. Big, big hands of praise unto him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I want to welcome us into God's presence. Everyone that is here in the sanctuary and those who are watching online, I pray that the blessings of today will not pass you by in the name of Jesus. And we want to give our hands unto God for what the children did last week. Let's give it up unto him. Hallelujah for all our children for such a wonderful ministration last week. We thank God for their lives. And the Lord will continue to give them wisdom and understanding in the name of Jesus Christ. So immediately after service, we want to have a brief meeting with all men. It's just going to be like 5 minutes, brief meeting with all men. Just we are going to wait on this side of the aisle so we can discuss about the picnic. Then this Friday, we'll be having our perennial encounter night. We need to come and pray. And the theme is, lift up your heads, O ye gates. If there has been any gate that has been confronting you When we come together on Friday, every gate shall be lifted in the name of Jesus Christ. And on Wednesdays, we always have our Rema Hour. What does that mean? It's a time that we come together to break the bread, to study at the feet of our Lord Jesus Christ. You know, many times when you are by yourself, you have limited understanding of the Bible. But when we come together as a family, then people bring different perspectives, different revelation about the Word of God. And many times, some of us don't even have anything we are doing on Wednesdays, 7 to 8 o'clock, just 1 hour, to sit at the feet of Jesus to learn. I've been learning a lot. God gives inspiration to people. And just one verse of the Bible, when they begin to explain what the Holy Spirit ministers unto them, you will be amazed. So if you have nothing doing or you are not busy on this Wednesday, please join us. It's just 1 hour, and you don't need to come here into the sanctuary. It's online. We bring church to your bedroom. We bring church to your living room. And for that 1 hour, your life can change forever. So let's get together on Wednesday at the Rema Hour, and the Lord will bless us as we do in Jesus' name. How many remember the theme of our theme for this month of July? Supernatural revival. We have been talking about supernatural revival. And today we will continue. And the topic for today's message is stay awake. Tell your neighbor, please stay awake. Tell the other person, please stay awake. Aha, so it's necessary because sometimes when we stay here, we see people that are sleeping. So, but stay awake today, because the message will be a blessing unto you in the mighty name of Jesus. Don't be like that man, you know, he was sleeping in the church and the pastor was, they were discussing about an issue. And they were saying, okay, we are going to raise funds. We know some of you are really blessed. Some people are going to give 1,000. Some people are going to give 1,000,000. And the Bible, and the pastor said, you know, there's nothing God cannot do. There's maybe some brothers here that are going to give 1,000,000. If you are the brother, just stand up. This man was sleeping. All of a sudden, he just stood up. And the pastor said, let's come for our brother. He's going to give us 1,000,000. The man looked right. He looked right, left. He said, what are they saying? And the pastor said, but you got up. He said, but I don't know what you are saying, but I see that it's only me and you that got up. Because he was sleeping all the time, but just had stand up and he got up. So please don't sleep this morning. So our scripture is taken from Matthew chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26, from verse 36 to 46. Then Jesus went with his disciples to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to them, sit here while I go over there and pray. He took Peter and the two sons of Zebedee along with him, and he began to be sorrowful and troubled. Then he said to them, my soul is overwhelmed with sorrow to the point of death. Stay here and keep watch with me. Going a little further, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, my Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will. Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. Couldn't you men keep watch with me for 1 hour? He asked Peter, watch and pray, so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away a second time and prayed, my Father, if it is not possible For this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done. When he came back, he again found them sleeping because their eyes were heavy. So he left them and went away once more and prayed the third time, saying the same thing. When he returned to the disciples, I said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? Look, the hour has come, and the Son of Man is delivered into the hands of sinners. Rise, let us go. Here comes my betrayer. May the Lord bless the reading of his word in Jesus' name. Father in heaven, we thank you for your word is already blessed. As we listen to your word, let our hearts be open in the mighty name of Jesus. The Bible says the entrance of your word gives life and it gives understanding to the simple. My Lord and my God, as we hear your word, let your word profit us today in the mighty name of Jesus. Lord, we pray, let something of eternal value be deposited into our lives and let your name be glorified. Jesus' wonderful name, we have prayed. Amen. Sleep is part of God's plan for us to be able to refresh and renew our strength after a long day. So there is nothing wrong in sleeping. It is part of God's plan to ensure that we regain our energy and to be refreshed. Because it is impossible and it is very difficult for a man to go without sleep for 72 hours. If you don't sleep for a day, you will feel it, let alone not sleeping for like 2 or 3 days. If you don't sleep for like 3 days, I bet you, on the third day, you'll be disoriented. And if you are not careful, you'll begin to hallucinate. That is excessive sleep deprivation. For people that, you know, want to get information from criminals, they use sleep deprivation. They keep them awake for days. And if you have been lying before, you will discover that by the third day, you'll be telling, even the one you didn't do, you will tell them. Because our body has limited capacity to withstand sleeplessness. So, if it is natural that we sleep, it is then means that sleep is not a problem. But God has given us that there is a specific time to sleep, and there is a specific time to be awake. So, which means if you sleep when you're supposed to be awake, it's misnomer. And when you are awake when you're supposed to be sleeping, it's misnomer. Actually, the Bible says that God gives his beloved sleep. So sleep is not bad. In Proverbs chapter 10, verse 5, Proverbs chapter 10, verse 5, the Bible says that he who gathers crops in summer is a prudent son. It said, but he who sleeps during harvest is a disgraced son. So which means there is a specific time to sleep and there is a specific time to be awake. Also in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, from verse 6 to 7, 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, from verse 6 to 7, the Bible says, therefore, let us not sleep as others do, but let us watch and be sober. For those who sleep at night, and those who get drunk are drunk at night. When we look at all these scriptures, all these scriptures are just telling us that as good as sleep is to refresh our body and for us to regain our strength, but there is always an appropriate time to sleep. There's a story in the scripture of a young man in Acts chapter 20 where Apostle Paul was about to travel the following day and he had to preach for a long time. And this man slept, and the Bible said he fell from the third story. That scripture is, let me read it quickly. First, Acts of Apostles chapter 20 from verse 7 to 12. On the first day of the week, we came together to break bread. Paul spoke to the people, and because he intended to leave the next day, he kept on talking until midnight. There were many lamps in the upstairs room where they were meeting. Seated in a window was a young man named Eutychus, who was sinking into a deep sleep. As Paul talked on and on, when he was sound asleep, he fell to the ground from the third story. And he was picked up dead. Paul went down and threw himself on the young man, and he put his arms around him. He said, "Don't be alarmed, he's alive." Then he went upstairs again and broke bread and ate. After talking until daylight, he left. The people took the young man home alive, and they were greatly comforted. Don't sleep in church, oh, because the anointing to wake the dead may not be present the day you sleep. Thank God for this man, because the anointing to wake the dead was upon Paul that day. If not, he would have been singing with the angels in heaven. It just shows that there's a time to sleep, and there's a time not to sleep. There's a time to stay awake. And that's why David says in Psalm 13, verse 3, Psalm 13, verse 3, David cried out. He said, "Consider and hear me, O Lord my God." He said, "Lighten my eyes, or else I will sleep the sleep of death." May you not sleep the sleep of death, in the mighty name of Jesus. Why? David knew that sleeping, when he was supposed to stay at the watchtower watching, is very dangerous. When you sleep, when you're supposed to be watching, you expose yourself to the enemy. May your life not be exposed to the hands of the enemy, in the mighty name of Jesus. You know, sleeping, naturally, people don't fall asleep suddenly. No, except you are under anesthesia. You don't fall asleep. Sleep is a process. And I was looking at how do we get to deep sleep. Initially, you stay awake. We all stay awake. Then the next thing, when you begin to yawn, that is the process that maybe you are getting tired. Sleep is coming. So sleep starts with yawning. From yawning, you get to nodding off. Then you begin to do your head like this. When people look at you, you just pretend that nothing is happening. From nodding, you get to what I call half sleep. When you are half asleep, you are hearing what people are saying, but you are already going. Has that happened to you before? You can hear everybody around you, but you are already transiting into another life. That is half asleep. I remember when I was in graduate school, I was working full time. And in the evening, I would go to school. Half of the time, the lecturer would be speaking, and I'm hearing it in the third heaven. And sometimes, they say, "Oh, you are so tired." Then I wake up, I say, "Yes, I am tired." That is half asleep. Then from half asleep, you transition to another one I call consciously asleep. You're already asleep, but if somebody opens your door, you will know. You're already asleep, but you are still a little bit conscious. Then from that, you fall into what I call deep slumber. At that time, even if the house is burning, you don't even know what is going on. That is a process of how we sleep sometimes. But we are not talking about physical sleep today, because this is not a sleep clinic that we are in. We want to talk about spiritual sleep, and that is what we want to talk about. Because naturally we all sleep and we all wake up. But we want to talk about spiritual sleep. We are more concerned about that. So, a period of sleep, spiritually, we always indicate the following, which may even have some relevance with the natural sleep. A period of spiritual slumber is a period of inactivity. A period of inactivity. You are not doing anything at that time, because you are already asleep. A period of spiritual slumber is a period of limited unconsciousness of your surrounding. You are limited about how conscious you are about your surrounding. You are already sleeping. If somebody is already asleep, if you bring a dagger close to his head, he doesn't know. If you bring fire close to his head, except the heat, touch him, he probably will not know. If a man is sleeping, a thief may sneak into his room and steal his valuables and sneak out. He will never know. Why? Because it's a period of unconsciousness of your surrounding. The third indicator of sleeping spiritually is that it is a period of disconnection between you and your real self. You are disconnected from you and your real self. No matter how strong a man is, when he sleeps, he becomes powerless. You may have, the presidents of this world and the heads of nations of this world, when they sleep, they only have sentry. They have security around at the door. But inside the house, the man is already gone. So if death sneaks into the house, the man is gone. Because the security cannot stop death from killing the strong man. So when we are saying that spiritual sleep is what we are talking about, we are not talking about natural sleep. Because a man that sleeps naturally, some of us, we have alarm. Once the alarm goes off, then we wake up, we go to work. No matter how tired we are the previous night, if you are supposed to get to work at 7 a.m., once you get up at 5 a.m., you get ready and you still make it to work. But we are talking today about spiritual sleep. So let's look at spiritual inactivity. We mentioned three indicators. Spiritual inactivity, we mentioned unconscious of our surrounding, then we mentioned disconnection. So let's look at spiritual inactivity. When a man is asleep spiritually, such a person, these are the things you will notice, such a person becomes lethargic to the things of the kingdom. Things of the kingdom becomes boring to you. Then it means maybe you are already sleeping spiritually. When a man is spiritually asleep, it means that man is no longer excited about things of God. When they mention things of the kingdom of God, you no longer feel excited about it. You need to check yourself. Maybe you are already spiritually asleep. Another indicator is that the gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ becomes a laborious exercise for that person. when they mention about things of God, things about Lord Jesus Christ, gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ, it becomes a struggle to that person. That person needs to check himself or herself. Another indicator is that you no longer have the burden to witness and win souls for the kingdom. Just say, well, anybody that wants to go to hell can go to hell. It doesn't concern me. Check yourself whether you are still awake or you are already sleeping. Another thing is that someone who is suffering from spiritual inactivity, service in the households of God becomes so boring that you do it grudgingly. Grudgingly. You begin to grudgingly serve God. Oh, if I don't go now, maybe pastor will now be texting me that we didn't see you in church. Not that you really want to go. Not that you are cheerful about it. It becomes service without joy. If you are coming to church or you are serving in any department in the church, and it's like, I don't even want to go, but what will they say? It means you are sleeping. For somebody who is spiritually asleep, prayer life becomes non-existent. It's no longer praying. You used to pray 1 hour. You used to pray 30 minutes. Even to pray 2 minutes becomes a problem. You are sleeping, and you need to wake up. Finally, studying the Word of God has dropped to zero. Carrying the Word of God becomes a struggle. Even when we say, let's come together on Wednesday to share the Word together so we can learn together, the Bible says, iron sharpens iron. You don't have the time. You rather watch TV. It means you are sleeping spiritually. And the Lord will quicken you. It will quicken your mortal body in the mighty name of Jesus. Another characteristic of a man who is spiritually asleep is spiritual unconsciousness. We have spoken about spiritual inactivity, then spiritual unconsciousness. What does that mean? It means someone who is oblivious about his environment. If a man is unconscious, that man does not know what is going on again in his environment. Like a man that faints. It means spiritually you have fainted. You don't know what is going on in your environment. Such a person may be unconscious to the reality around him. But when you are unconscious, sometimes you are awake in a different reality. Because sometimes when people faint, and they wake up, they say, you just fainted. He will say, I didn't know. What happened? He will find himself somewhere else during the period of unconsciousness. And that's why sometimes when we sleep, we dream. And sometimes the dream, while you are still sleeping, looks like real to you. Have you ever slept and they gave you money, a lot of money? And you are saying, I don't want to wake up. And you keep the money under your pillow, and you wake up and you open. You try to search because it's a lot of dollars. And you try to open your pillow, you discover that there is nothing there. You are in another reality entirely. Even though you are unconscious, but you are waking up in another reality. And when you are spiritually unconscious, you may be in another reality. And let's look at the characteristics of somebody who is spiritually unconscious. When you are spiritually unconscious, it is a state of extreme vulnerability because the enemy can take advantage of you. When a man is spiritually unconscious, you are open to attack easily. And Satan knows when we are spiritually unconscious. And that is when he attacks most. A period of spiritual unconsciousness is a state where your faith has been wiped out. And it has been replaced with false narrative or false alternative. You used to believe in God. You used to believe in Christ. You used to worship Him. You used to, you know, believe in the Trinity, Holy Spirit, God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. But because you have been spiritually unconscious for a long time, you no longer believe that again. And you begin to embrace the new world order. And sometimes you begin to question even your faith. Such a person is no longer conscious to sin. Sin does not have any effect on you again because you are already spiritually unconscious. For such a person, the conscience of that person is already seared. It doesn't matter. When you used to be in Christ, if you sin, it will really touch you. But at this moment, sin does not even touch you again. It does not matter. You go all out into it. You're unfaithful to your wife, it does not matter. You just feel it's pleasurable. It's a period where sin becomes pleasurable because that person is totally unconscious spiritually. It is a period when sin becomes pleasurable and you may even begin to doubt God. Does he even really exist? Maybe this Christianity is just a game. Then you need to pinch yourself and bring yourself alive so that you can be awake. And finally, the third characteristic of somebody who is spiritually slumbering is that there's a disconnection between that person and his real self. His real self, as a child of God, is no longer the person we are seeing right now. He has been disconnected. You know, in mental health, we call that depersonalization. Actually, there is a disorder called depersonalization, where you are totally detached from yourself, and you begin to see yourself as a different person. You don't see yourself as who you are. You are seeing a different image of yourself. At this stage, such a person who is spiritually disconnected has removed the garment of righteousness. That person has removed the garment of holiness, and he begins to feel comfortable in the worldly garment. That person, even if you talk about Christ to him, he will fight you. He has gotten to that level because he's totally disconnected from who he used to be. There are a lot of Christians that used to be fervent for the Lord, but they have passed through a lot of stages of sleeping, and they are now so much into slumber that when you mentioned Christ, they will fight you. They will tell you, we have been there before. What do you want to tell us? Some will even tell you, I used to be an altar boy in Catholic. When I left there, I became born again. We did everything. You know, when we discover some of those pastors were just fake. I just say, this is a game. I'm no longer doing. And from that day, they will even tell you today, they are now an atheist. Somebody that does not believe God. At that moment, that person is totally disconnected. It's only the Holy Spirit that can bring him back. And that is why we need to keep constantly checking our faith. Because I took us through the process of sleeping. You don't sleep suddenly. It's a process. Are you yawning? Are you already nodding off? Are you half awake, half asleep? Or are you consciously sleeping? Or you are already in deep slumber? You need to keep checking yourself. Because nobody can get to that level of total disconnect in one day. It's a gradual process. I pray that the Lord will help to keep us awake in the mighty name of Jesus Christ. In that scripture, our text scripture that we read, in Matthew chapter 26, it's the story of our Lord Jesus Christ and three of his very close confidants, Peter, James, and John. Jesus was about to be taken up, was about to be betrayed, and he was about to be arrested. And he was feeling so strongly about that. His faith became very troubled, and he had to go and pray. And he took with him people that he thought should help him to pray. And the three men went with him, and rather than praying with him, they were sleeping. And Jesus, three times, with frustration, with disappointment, he kept coming back to them. Please, can you please pray with me? Why are you sleeping? He will go. Immediately he goes, they start sleeping. He will come back. On the third time, he told them that they should continue sleeping. And he went and carried the body by himself. What the three did not know was that praying with Jesus was not for Jesus alone. Praying with Jesus was even for them more than Jesus, because Jesus came to die anyway. He specifically told Peter, he said, Peter, he said, watch and pray, lest you enter into temptations. The same Peter, if he had prayed while he was in Gethsemane, he would not become the one that a housemaid, just a maid, recognized him and said, you look like one of the one that was with Jesus, and he began to deny Jesus three times. These disciples, if they had prayed with him, they would not be running. You know, after he was arrested, all of them ran away. And they went to hide themselves in a building. And they went through a lot of problems. Had they prayed, they didn't pray. When Jesus said to them, pray with me, they thought, why should we pray for you? Why should we be praying with you? You know, sometimes the Holy Spirit will wake up in the middle of the night and say, pray. They say, I'm too tired. You might be praying for somebody that God wants to save. But when we say, you know what, I don't need to pray, I'm too tired, then what will happen will still happen. But my prayer is that we will not sleep the sleep of death in the mighty name of Jesus, that the Lord will continue to strengthen us and keep us awake in the mighty name of Jesus. So, three major areas we need to be careful about not to experience spiritual slumber are the following. Number one is our prayer life. We have to be very careful. When your prayer life begins to go down, you are opening the gates for the enemy. And that's why sometimes corporate prayer can help. This Friday we are saying, let's come together and pray. When you see other people praying, that will energize your zeal to pray. But that will not take your personal prayer life from you. You need to, especially those of us who are married, pray with your wife. Pray with your husband. Pray with your family. It helps you. It helps your prayer life. And if you are single, pray, look for a prayer partner that will be, so that you can be encouraging one another. And when it's time for you to have your own private devotion, Pray. Time yourself. Let me pray for 15 minutes. From 15 minutes, let me pray for 30 minutes. Gradually, you begin to strengthen your prayer muscle. It is an area we need to be very careful so we will not experience spiritual slumber. Number two, the other area we need to be very careful about is the study of God's word. When you don't have the word in your life, it's easier for the enemy to misdirect you. When Satan took Jesus to the mountaintop, everything he said, Jesus had the word against it. When you are immersed in the word of God, it becomes practically impossible for you to sleep spiritual slumber. To get into spiritual slumber. You need to be on fire with the word of God. And the third one is the zeal for kingdom service. One of the major areas where you need to measure whether you are sleeping or not is how fervent are you for the things of the kingdom. When they mention things of God's kingdom, how excited are you? When it's no longer when you are no longer excited about serving the Lord, you need to begin to pinch yourself so that you can come back alive. So whenever we begin to see slack in these three major areas, you need revival. And I pray that the Lord will revive us in Jesus' name. So finally, as we close, what do I need to do to stay awake? What do I need to do? Number one, you need to stay alive in the Spirit. Stay alive in the Spirit. Romans chapter 8, verse 11. But if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who dwells in you. We must be alive in the Holy Spirit at all times. It is very important. You need to stay awake by staying alive in the Spirit. Number two, stay in fellowship. Stay in fellowship. Bible encourages us in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 25, that we should not forsake the assembling of ourselves together as the manner of some is, but exhorting one another, and so much the more as you see the day approaching. Let's come together from time to time and sharpen ourselves. One of the things the enemy always does to kill a believer is to take that person away from the fellowship of fellow brethren. You will make sure that you pick an offense and you say, there is no love in that church. I mean, if there is no love in that church, go to another church where you will find love. But the enemy will not allow you to go to another. He will let you stay by yourself alone. And it is easier to be attacked when you are by yourself. Let's stay in fellowship. When we stay in fellowship, it helps us to stay awake. When you are by yourself alone, you will sleep off and you will not know what is going on. It is difficult when we say, everybody stand up, let's be praising God. It is difficult for you to be sleeping while you are praising God. I know some people can sleep standing. I know that one. But sometimes it's difficult. But when you are by yourself, it is easier to sleep. Number three, how do I stay awake? Do a regular spiritual self-check. A regular spiritual self-check. We go to our doctors every now and then to see how well we are doing physically. Spiritually, we need to do the same thing. We need to do the same thing. 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 5. The Bible says, examine yourselves as to whether you are in the faith. Test yourselves. Do you not know yourselves that Jesus Christ is in you, unless indeed you are disqualified? Bible encourages us to always check. I have to check my battery. Is it still on or is very weak? And that's why When we come on Friday, we do communion, we recharge. And we encourage ourselves in the word, and we pray together. Then we are recharged. And number four says, be passionate in service. Romans 12:11, not lagging in diligence. Fervent in spirit, serving the Lord. In service, be excited to serve the Lord. And finally, watch and pray. Watch and pray. Jesus told Peter, watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. As you are praying, you are watching. You are sensitive to the Holy Spirit and you are alive. I pray the Lord will keep you awake in the name of Jesus. Let us pray. You are going to tell God, Father, quicken me by the power of your Holy Spirit. Don't let me sleep the sleep of death in the mighty name of Jesus. Go ahead and pray that prayer for yourself. Father, I pray that you quicken me by the power of your Holy Spirit, that I will not sleep the sleep of death in the mighty name of Jesus. Wake me up, O Lord, from the slumber in the mighty name of Jesus. Spiritually, Lord Almighty, don't let me fall into deep slumber in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' precious name, we pray. Second prayer point, we are going to say, Father, keep me awake spiritually. Don't let me open the gate of my life for the enemy. Go ahead and pray that prayer, Father, in the name of Jesus. Keep me spiritually awake in the name of Jesus. Don't let me open the gate of my life to the enemy. In the mighty name of Jesus, Father, keep me awake spiritually. Keep me awake spiritually in the name of Jesus. Finally, you are going to say, Father, revive me from spiritual unconsciousness. Keep me alive in Christ. Revive me, O Lord, from spiritual unconsciousness. In the mighty name of Jesus, revive me, O Lord Almighty. Keep me alive in Christ. In the name of Jesus. Instill in the attitudes of prayer. If you are here and you just know within yourself, be true to yourself, that I'm not even yawning, I'm not nodding. I am in deep spiritual sleep right now. I know. Whether you are here or you are watching online, or you have never even given your life to Christ before, you don't even know what it means to be spiritually asleep. And you want to surrender your life to Christ, because once you surrender your life to Christ, there is a new spirit that comes inside of you. It's like a battery of a car that is dead. And another car is now used even to kickstart the new battery. It's going to gain some power. So the power of the Holy Spirit is what will kickstart you so that it will wake you up from the slumber. And you want to give your life to Christ, or you have been sleeping and you want to, you know, be reawakened by the power of the Holy Spirit, all you need to do is to place your right hand on your chest and I will pray with you. And you are going to say with me, you are going to say, Lord Jesus, I come unto you. I accept you as my personal Lord and Savior today. I confess that I am a sinner. Help my unbelief. As I accept you, Holy Spirit, come into my life. Quicken my mortal body. Let me be alive in you. Write my name in the book of life. Let the blood of Jesus wash me clean of every unrighteousness. Establish me in your kingdom. If you have said that prayer, I want to say congratulations. I pray that the Spirit of God will perfect all that concern you. You will no longer fall into deep slumber in the mighty name of Jesus. The Lord will keep you awake until he's coming. In the mighty name of Jesus, if you have been blessed, if you are alive and you are awake, let's put our hands together for Jesus. Hallelujah. 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 This time, we want to give our tithe. And for those who are either you have given your tithe in course of the week, or you are here this morning and you want to give your tithe, we want to pray. So So I will want us to rise on our feet for those who are giving their tithe. For those who are giving their tithe, rise unto your feet quickly so we can pray. Our Father in heaven, we want to say thank you for the opportunity to be awake, to be conscious, to be sensitive to your commandment and your instruction. Thank you, O Lord, because in obedience to your word, you said we should bring a tenth of our increase into your storehouse so that there shall be meat in your house. My Father and my God, as we obey you, O Lord, every benefit of that commandment, every promise of that commandment, let the promise begin to work for us. In the name of Jesus, open the windows of heaven towards us. In the mighty name of Jesus, rebuke devourers for our sake. In the mighty name of Jesus, teach our hands to prosper. In the mighty name of Jesus, in your kingdom, Lord, make us to be treasurers. In the mighty name of Jesus, thank you, everlasting Savior, for we are prayed in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. So, at this time, we want to give our offering. Let's begin to package our offering. Bible tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 7, says, every man, let him give according as he has purpose in his heart, not grudgingly, nor of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver. Giving to the kingdom of God should not be by compulsion. Giving to the kingdom of God should be by understanding. And when you come to the understanding of the covenant of giving and receiving, you will understand when the Bible says it is more, we are more blessed in giving than receiving. The Bible says, what is it that has been given unto you that you did not receive from above? Everything we have, the Lord made it possible. And it should not be a struggle for us to give out of the abundance he has blessed us with, to sow a seed into his kingdom for the furtherance of his kingdom here on earth. And as we do so, through different platforms through which we can give, I pray that the Lord Almighty we replenish back unto us hundredfold return in the name of Jesus. If you want to give by check, you want to give by cash, you want to give through different platforms, or you want to go to the back of the auditorium where we have the machine for the POS there, you can do whatever your heart so desires. My prayer is that your giving will be acceptable unto him. In the name of Jesus, let us bless the offering. Father, we thank you for the opportunity even to be alive, because we know only the living can give into your kingdom. Our Father and our God, out of the provisions you have made available to us, we have brought this as a token to appreciate you for being our source. My Father and my God, we pray as we continue to be a blessing to your kingdom, we pray that our source of supply will not dry up. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray, Almighty God, that the heavens will breathe upon our finances. In the mighty name of Jesus, may we not beg for bread. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray, Almighty God, as we give, cause men to give back unto us. In the mighty name of Jesus, we pray, everlasting Savior, Lord, the showers of blessings begin to come upon our finances. Thank you, everlasting Savior, because we have prayed In Jesus' mighty name, amen. So before we close the service, we want to welcome some special people in our midst. Those are the people who are worshiping here for the very first time in Christ Villa. If you are here for the very first time, we don't want to take your coming here for granted. We want to celebrate you, we want to recognize you. All we need you to do is just wave your hand so we can recognize you and just celebrate you. Anyone at the back, God bless you. God bless you. God bless you, my brother. God bless you, my brother. God bless you, my sister, right here on this side. There's somebody on this side. God bless you. Keep your hands up. Keep your hands up until the usher gets to you. God bless you. God bless you. Let's be seated. For those who are worshiping with us for the very first time, we just want to say we appreciate you. We love you with the love of Christ. We don't want to take you for granted because, you know, we don't know how many churches you passed before you came to Christ Villa. We are a part of the Redeemed Christian Church of God worldwide. This is Christ Villa Church, a place of impact. If the Lord is speaking to you or the Spirit of God is, you know, telling you that this is your family, we'll be glad to have you as a family in Christ Villa Church. We're a family church. After the service, our welcome team will come to you, tell you more about the church, take you to our welcome room. Then I will be coming there to welcome you formally. And my prayer is that every blessing that the Lord Almighty has deposited in your life today, I pray that they shall be permanent. In the name of Jesus, whatever concern you have left at home, coming to church, the Lord Almighty will turn them to testimony. In the mighty name of Jesus, let's give a big hands of praise to the Lord. Hallelujah for these wonderful people. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Before we close, they're going to display, okay, this barcode that is being displayed is for our Bible study. Some people may say, oh, I don't have the link to the Bible study. On Wednesday, I want to join at 7, between 7 and 8, but I don't have the link, the Zoom link. If you scan this, it will take you straight to the Zoom link. Then you can save it. It's the same Zoom link that we use every Wednesday, so you can always join. And we have been discussing, we are talking about the book of Genesis. We have been on the book of Genesis. Last week, we've been talking about Noah and, how God used water to brought flood upon the face of the earth, how Noah built the ark. Now we are continuing, and the revelation that God is sending to his children, they are just so marvelous. So you want to be part of the Bible study this Wednesday by the special grace of God. It's not more than 1 hour, and the blessing will be of a lifetime in the name of Jesus. So let's lay aside any other thing we may be doing within that hour, except you're at work. Even some people join when they're at work. It's just going to be, you can use an earpiece and mute yourself, and you'll be listening to all the messages and all the discussion. The Lord will bless us as we do in Jesus' name. So shall we rise as we close this service? Amen. Please don't forget, just 5 minutes, you'll be waiting here on my right for a brief meeting. If you're a man, make sure you don't leave for this brief meeting. It's not going to take long. Father in heaven, we want to say thank you for the opportunity to gather at your feet once again to be blessed of you. Thank you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit. Thank you for this service. Thank you, Almighty God, for the ministrations of your children. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the attendance. Thank you for the giving of your children. Thank you, Father, for the presence of your Holy Spirit. Lord, we pray that every word you have spoken to us, my Father and my God, we pray, let your word profit us in the mighty name of Jesus. We don't want to be hearers alone. Father, make us to be doers of your word in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we have looked at your word concerning revival. Lord, we pray that you revive us. In the mighty name of Jesus, as many of us that may be sleeping, Father, Lord, let your Holy Spirit wake us back up. In the mighty name of Jesus, spiritually, may we not sleep the sleep of death. In the mighty name of Jesus, my Father, my God, whatever may be making us to be drowsy, Father, spiritually, Father, Lord, take away from us, O Lord. In the mighty name of Jesus, in this new week, Father, Lord, do a new thing. In the mighty name of Jesus, visit us with a new joy in the mighty name of Jesus. Let your peace abide with us. Father, Lord, hide us in your pavilion as we travel through the roads and the highways. Father, let your safety be strengthened upon us in the mighty name of Jesus. Concerning us, there shall be no emergencies in the mighty name of Jesus. When we hear from one another, Lord, let it be good news in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, we thank you. In Jesus' precious name we have prayed. Amen. Have a wonderful week. God bless you all. Amen.